Open up your word and to read it and to study it this morning. And we pray, Father, that your spirit would just lead and direct us and help this preacher to bring forth truths we need to be reminded of and we need to hear. And Lord, help our minds to be receptive and inspire us to go on and to take the truth that we read about here today and to go on to use it in our life that we might reach others for Jesus Christ also. Pray that you'd bless this hour and also the hour that is to come, Lord. For we ask it in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. All right, I'd like you to open your Bibles up, if you will, to chapter 4 of the book of Hebrews. It's not a very long chapter, so I think I will end up reading the entire chapter, although we're mainly going to be preaching out of just a few verses, okay? We're teaching out of it. And the theme of our Sunday school lessons this week, and it's probably going to take more than this week, so we're probably not going to finish this Sunday school lesson until next week. But anyway, the title of it is Our Great High Priest. You can just imagine who this is about. Amen? Okay, all right. Okay, Hebrews chapter 4. And in verse 1, do you folks want to stand for reading of this, or do you usually stand? Okay, all right. I don't want to do anything different than what you usually do. Okay. All right. I'm standing no matter what. So, okay. All right. Hebrews chapter 4 and in verse 1, the Word of God says, "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, if they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief, again he limiteth a certain day, saying to David, Today, after so long a time, as it is said, Today if ye will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open under the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Thank you, Lord, for this time we've had together. We ask your blessing on the remaining words of this lesson, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Okay. And this is quite a chapter. The verses that I'm really going to be preaching off of, course, is verses 14 through 16. Notice in verse 14 it says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens." And that's where we get the title of our Sunday school lesson here, is Our Great High Priest. The book of Hebrews was written to a group of Jews who had been exiled from Israel, and the book was addressed to the Jewish community to encourage them in their walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the majority of the book was written to believers to encourage them to remain faithful in their commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. This book was also written to unsaved Jews who had abandoned Judaism, but who have yet to believe on Jesus Christ. They're called upon at this stage to trust Jesus Christ and to enter into his rest and to be saved. And that's what we found there in verses 1 through 13 of that chapter. Now, the major appeal thus far in the chapter has been negative. The message has been, if you don't come to Jesus, you're going to be doomed. I guess we might say that from the beginning of the book. So these unconverted Jews are called upon to escape hell by coming to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. And by the way, that's one thing that people do have to be reminded of in today's day and age, that there is a hell. And that it's not a place where friends are going to gather and have a nice card game and watch NFL football all of the rest of their life. And it's not going to be that way. The Bible tells us that it's a place where the worm dieth not. Tells us it's a place of misery and a place where gnashing of teeth. My own picture of hell, I guess everybody kind of conjures one up in their own mind. But my own picture of hell is kind of like looking at the midway of the state fair, where you see everybody crammed in all together, okay? And yet not knowing one another, okay? And it's like they're all alone in the crowd. And so here you are in the masses of the crowd, and yet you don't have a friend around. And of course, the other thing about it is it's a place of loneliness, blackness. And then, of course, it's in the center of the earth, so I got the idea that we're always being, that, not me, but those that are there are being tumbled around, kind of like in the drum of a dryer. Okay, all right. So it's a place of misery and torment, misery of flame and all of that. It's not a very pretty picture. And I think that many people need to be reminded that there is a hell, and any sane person would not want to go there. So they ought to have that vision of hell in their mind. Anyway, so, the writer here, which I believe is the Apostle Paul, one of the strong reasons, and I've not been through the entire book looking for it again, I need to go back through it again, but there's some evidence in there that I believe concludes to me that Paul wrote it. But one of the most prominent evidences of it is that whichever one of the apostles wrote this book, all right, they had to be extremely familiar with the priesthood. That's why I believe the Apostle Paul was the one that wrote it, okay? The others were familiar with the temple and all of that, but they were not anywhere near as familiar with the priesthood as was the Apostle Paul. But anyway, after he shifts, gets going along here, he shifts to the positive side of the gospel. And we need to remember that salvation does keep us out of hell, but it also does a lot more than that. Salvation delivers us from death. Not only does it deliver us from death, but it also gives us eternal life. And that's not to be sneezed at. You know, it's nice to have forgiveness of sins, but it's even better to be given eternal life. Amen? Okay. So salvation also changes our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now the lost are going to face the Lord Jesus Christ as their judge. And the redeemed, all right, who know the Lord Jesus as their Savior and Lord, are going to see him as Savior. So they're not going to have a very pleasant judgment when they have denied who he was and everything else all of their life. The Jews who received this letter were used to gaining their access to God through a human priest. When they wanted to get something to God, they would go down to the temple, go to the priest, and so forth like that. But Paul here, I'm going to call Paul the writer, so you know where I'm coming from, wants them to know that saving faith in Jesus Christ provides believers with a high priest who is far better than any human high priest. And this passage highlights the characteristics that make the Lord Jesus Christ worthy to be called our great high priest. And I believe there is much needed, some much needed help in these verses today. And I think we all need help as we pass through this world, unless you're some super character that that I don't know about. But I know I've needed help from time to time, and sometimes the only one that could actually help would have been the Lord, and has been the Lord. And the person that we need to help us and to encourage us and strengthen us is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's revealed in this passage, and that's who we want to talk about as our great high priest today. So we want to look at some of the characteristics that are revealed about him in these verses. Now I want you to notice here in verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. All right? We notice here that our high priest is he's superior. He's superior in his personality. The ancient Jews depended on their high priest. He was the man who represented them to the Lord. And he was the man who interceded for them before the Lord. He was a man who offered the blood sacrifices that atoned for their sins. The high priest was an important part of their lives. It was an important part of their worship and their relationship with God. But they had one major problem with their high priest, and that is he was still human.
Amen.
He was still just plain human. And when I say that, I know we know that Jesus was human also. But these were human beings that still had a sin nature. And even though they were supposed to have some exemplary manner of life, yet they were flawed characters just like we are. And so that left them all a little bit short. They needed forgiveness. Their priests needed forgiveness just like the people they represented. In fact, if we remember anything about studying the temple, and I'm sure that you guys have studied the temple and the tabernacle and so forth like that, but the high priest would have to take the blood of the sacrifice that was given, and he would actually have to go in, he would actually have to sprinkle blood on the altar to for himself before he could actually make an atonement, going to make the atonement for the people's sins. So he had to get forgiveness first. These priests were prone to failure, just like the people they represented. But our high priest is superior because he's not just a human high priest, he's also the Son of God. He's the Son of Man and he's the Son of God. He is sinless and he cannot sin. He cannot fail. He does not need forgiveness because he's absolutely perfect. Absolutely perfect. That's kind of hard for us to imagine, but that's exactly what he is. He's not only superior, we talk about him being superior, his personality, he is superior in his performances, because every year on the day of Atonement, the high priest, and of course you've got to remember that as the years go by, these high priests die off and others are made the priests. They could only serve for a certain number of years. But anyway, that high priest would go in and offer a sacrifice for the sins of the people. But he had to do this every year, year after year after year. And he had to make a sacrifice every year. Before he went in for them, he had to make that sacrifice for his own sins. And then he took the blood of the atonement sacrifice into the Holy of Holies and sprinkled it on the mercy seat. And when he entered into the Holy of Holies, his time there was limited. He could only be there while he was offering the sacrifice. When he was finished, he had to leave the presence of the Lord. So every year, the same process had to be repeated, year after year after year. And to get to the Holy of Holies, the high priest had to pass through three portals. He passed through the gate into the courtyard of the tabernacle. He passed through the door into the holy place. Then he passed by the veil into the Holy of Holies, as it is told us in the book of Leviticus, chapter 16. And so, but this is something that the high priest had to do every single year. Now, Jesus is superior in his performance because Jesus has no sins of his own. But he made the atonement for our sins. We know in 2 Corinthians 5:21 that he that knew no sin was made sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. I might have paraphrased that a little bit. I'm not quite sure, but I believe I'm quite accurate on it. Over here in 1 Peter chapter 2 and in verse 24, speaking of Christ, it said, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Okay, we talk about what he has done for us. I know we're all familiar with this, but in 1 Peter 3:18 it says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust. Why did he do it? And that's, he's the just one, we're the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. So we can see that Christ made an atonement for our sins. He did not offer the blood of a goat. He offered his own sinless blood. Over here in Hebrews chapter 13 and in verse 12, the Word of God says, wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gate. And then, of course, we have to remember that he does not have to repeat his sacrifice year after year after year. We look over here in the book of Hebrews, continue on, I should say, in Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 11 and 12. It says there, and every priest standeth daily, ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. He's talking about the up there in verse 4, he said it's not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. That's what was being sacrificed all the time. And that just cannot do it, okay? But it says here in verse 11, every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. Basically, all they could do is just kind of like cover them up for a while. That's it, okay? And it said, but this man, after he had offered, that's Jesus, one sacrifice for sins forever, one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool, for by one offering he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. So we can see here that Christ only had to make one offering, and that was it. And then he could sit down. He didn't have to leave heaven right away. He didn't have to walk out of the Holy of Holies right away. There wasn't any time limit put on his presence before God the Father. All right. So in other words, his job was completed. Once he did it, he only had to do it one time. Never had to do it again. And you know, even today, in many different groups, we might even call them branches of Christianity or whatever like that. We have some priests that try to offer up the sacrifice of Christ in their daily masses and so forth like that. And yet, you know why they do that? Because they've never come to the point of really experiencing forgiveness. Look there at verse 17. It said, let's go back here to verse 16. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now he says in verse 18, now where remission of these is, that means where forgiveness of these is, there is no more offering for sin. So every time those in other groups continue to make offerings for sin, okay, they're just showing that they've never come to the point of really experiencing the forgiveness of sin that Jesus Christ has given them. Because you can't earn it by your works. You can't earn it by going through rituals. You can't get it by your church membership, and you can't get it in the baptistry tub or the baptistry font, whatever way they're doing it. You cannot get that forgiveness in any way by that way. You can't get forgiveness. You can't actually literally ingest the Lord Jesus Christ into your stomach anyway. And that is not going to bring forgiveness either. There's only going to be one thing that brings forgiveness, and that's when you come to the point of coming to Jesus Christ and trusting Him, not yourself, not a church, not your pastor, not any rituals or anything else, but just completely trusting what He did for you on the cross of Calvary. And when you put your trust in that, that's when you're born again into the family of God. Amen? Yeah. You become born again, you become redeemed, you're actually sanctified. You're almost, you're as good as in heaven. Not quite there yet, but it's going to come to pass. Okay? And so when you get saved, that's what our Lord does for you. So He didn't offer the blood of a goat. He offered His own sinless blood, and He doesn't have to repeat that sacrifice. What He did stands forever. And when He said, "It is finished," He meant it is finished. Amen? Okay. He didn't take His blood through three earthly portals like the human priest did. He passed through three heavens. Look back here, if you will, at 2 Corinthians chapter 12. We're not in any rush, so we might as well look at as much scripture as we can. Amen? Okay. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and look down here to verse 1. It said, "Now concerning spiritual gifts," wait a minute, I'm in 1 Corinthians. That's not going to work. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And in verse 1, it said, "It is not expedient for me to doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago, whether in body I cannot tell, or whether out of the body I cannot tell. God knoweth, for such an one caught up to the third heaven." Now, Paul's talking about being caught up to the third heaven. And, of course, we know there's a third heaven, so Christ had to pass through all three heavens. Amen? Okay, or pass, that's right. And to enter into the presence of the Almighty God. So he passed through the atmosphere, through the outer space, and into the celestial city of God. And Jesus offered His blood as the eternal payment for our sin debt. Let's go back to the book of Hebrews and look here at chapter 9 and chapter 9. You know, sometimes time dulls our memories a little bit, but I will tell you that back in 1983, we had Alberto Rivera at our church, and the news media tried to kill us. I mean, they just tried to bury us. And we got the brunt of it that week. There were several churches that had him in, and we just happened to be on the end of it, so we got the whole week's publicity of that week of it. And so I really did some studying on the Roman Catholicism and went right down to the Catholic bookstore and bought the St. Joseph's Baltimore Catechism, and I started reading through that because I wanted to know every in and out about Roman Catholicism that I could. And then I studied the book of Hebrews, and the book of Hebrews just totally, totally destroys the Roman Catholic system of theology when it comes to the doctrine of salvation. It truly does. And so it's a good book to know and to understand. But we look over here in Hebrews chapter 9, and we look at verse 23, and it says there, "It was therefore necessary that the patterns of things in the heavens should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as a high priest entereth into the holy place every year with the blood of others. For then must he have often suffered since the foundation of the world. But now once in the end of the world hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this the judgment, So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. You see, Jesus, when he offered his blood, he did what no earthly priest had ever done. He sat down on the right hand of God. The priest here on earth could never sit down once he went in the Holy of Holies. He could not sit down. And so Jesus was able to sit down on the right hand of God because his work was forever finished. Again, over there in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 12, this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. So you see, Jesus is a superior high priest because he purchased our eternal redemption when he died on the cross. He's not only superior in his performance, but he's also superior in his people. The Jews, by the way, were and you know, I'm not trying to pick on the Jews. Really, they're not any different than Gentiles. Problem is, we're all sinners. But as a nation, they were a fickle people. No matter how many times their priests made the atonement, the Jews were actually prone to abandon their commitment to the Lord. Time and time again, they wandered away from God. But Jesus is superior to human priests because his people hold fast to their profession. The phrase hold fast means to literally seize or to take hold of. Those who have been redeemed by the Lord Jesus Christ will, I guess we might say that they will persevere in their commitment to him. I think they're preserved in their commitment to him is a better way of doing it, because when we talk about persevering, we're talking about doing something in our own strength, but it's really done through the Lord Jesus Christ. We all fail him from time to time, but I don't believe that true believers can truly walk away from him. They might get a little backslidden, they might get a little away from the things of God, but you know, I don't believe a true believer can ever let go of his true identity as a Christian. I just don't think so. Maybe I'm wrong, but in the end, God's the final judge on that. They may falter, they may waver, but I don't think they drop out completely on God. And I think one sure mark of genuine salvation is that it produces a changed life. You know, some that I have seen that are professed to be saved and at some point in their life, I would never know it from their life. And I would never try to give them comfort in their security because they've not ever shown anything in it. The Bible tells me that if any man, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And, I laugh at guys when they get into the structure of that verse. Why don't you turn there for a minute, because I'll make a little comment on this. Because sometimes guys get into the Greek words. Usually the only reason I ever go to Greek words is to show you that the English was right all along. Okay, and but over here in 2 Corinthians, it's the second time I've tried to go in 1 Corinthians, 5:17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is, that's present tense, okay, a new creature, all right? Then it goes on to say, old things are, that's present tense. Past, that's past tense. Okay? Are passed away. So that's something that, in other words, that's something that started and continues on. It starts at a point and continues on. It's always are, okay? So there's always something still going on. And then in verse 17, old things are passed away. Behold, all things are present tense. Become, that's future, what? New. Amen? So there's a change that takes place. And you can see from that that it's a change that once it starts, it's something that continues until we're brought home to the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think if we're doing the right thing in our Christian life, what we should be doing is seeking to become more and more like Him as each day goes by. We had to have a new birth to do that. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, John 3:3. And I think that I think it creates in us a permanent desire to live for the Lord and to walk with Him. I can speak of this from my own experience. I think everybody else has to kind of check their own life. But I know when I thought about spiritual things before I ever got saved, I didn't want to be around preachers. I wasn't really interested in anybody who wanted to sit down and talk about the things of the Bible and so forth like that, because I was ignorant of it. Nobody likes to sit around and talk about things they're ignorant of, you know. And and I guess that's why nobody likes to talk about creation, because they're ignorant of it. But once I got saved, I just couldn't get enough of it. I couldn't get enough of the Bible. I wanted to be around people that believed this book. I wanted to be under a pastor that believed this book and taught this book, and I was just excited, man. I was just like a sponge that was wrung out and then thrown in an ocean of water, just absorbing everything I could, you know. And so I think that that's a normal experience that believers that get saved find. Now, they might be to different degrees and so forth like that. But the other thing that bothered me, of course, was we were in a liberal church, and the pastor was an unbeliever. It was in a congregational church. Excuse me. But I'll get rid of this sooner or later. Anyway, it bothered me because I realized I could sit in that church. My wife and I could have went to that church and just worked our fingers to the bone in that church, done everything there was in that church, and we could have died and went straight to hell, thinking that we were right with God. And we weren't. You know, we didn't understand what salvation was really totally about. And so we got saved, and then the Lord used that, I think, really, to call me into the ministry, because that was one of the thoughts that kept coming up in my mind, especially about people back in our area. We came from the Navarino area and the Syracuse area. Just kept saying, who's going to tell them? Who's going to tell them? And I think the Lord said, you're going to tell them. So that's how the Lord used that to get me into the ministry. All right, so anyway, we have the Lord Jesus Christ. He is a superior to an earthly priest because His followers are committed to Him and His will. Next, so we talk about our priest being superior. The next thing we talk about is found there in verse 15 of our text, and I guess I better get back there. Verse 15 of our text. And seeing as I'm coming back to that, I ought to set my marker there, hadn't I? Amen. I keep coming back to there. Verse 15, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. So our high priest is not only superior, but our high priest is truly sympathetic. He's sympathetic because of his human identity. And this verse makes it clear when it tells us that Jesus is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. One of the problems with a human priest is that he simply cannot know how you feel because he hasn't experienced all the things you're experiencing. He cannot fully sympathize with you. Jesus, on the other hand, can, because he's been through it all. I learned years ago quite one of the phrases that we're quite often use whenever we're dealing with somebody that's heartbroken or has some great loss, or they say, oh, yeah, brother, or yes, sister, I know exactly how you feel. And I learned years ago, I never say that anymore. I say, you know, I don't really know the fullness of how you feel, okay? I can just imagine it, okay? That's it. The only thing I can do is maybe give an experience maybe that I've had to identify with it. But the truth of the matter is, I don't really understand like Jesus Christ understood, okay? And Jesus can understand it. The phrase touched with the feeling translates, it doesn't make any difference. What it means is that gives us sympathy. The sympathy comes from the word sympathio, which means to be affected with the same feeling. So it's more than just feeling our pain. It kind of carries the idea of knowing how we feel, okay? But coupled along with that, with a desire to help. You know, I don't think it's just that our Lord said, oh yeah, I know exactly how you feel, and just leaves it at that. He cares about it enough that he wants to help us with it. So it's a caring heart that reaches out to help the hurting. Now, how did Jesus gain that kind of heart for his people? He gained it by becoming human. Isn't that right? The Bible says there in John chapter 1, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. There in verse 1 and then verse 14, says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So we can see that we can see that our God actually left the glories of heaven, and that he came down into this earth and dwelt as a man. But you know, it's not just dwelt as a man. He came into this world the same way you and I come into this world. And you know, this is amazing when we think about God himself actually entering into this world and placing himself completely at the mercy of a human mother and a stepfather and all of those around him and everything else. That's amazing. And yeah, and so he as a human being was totally reliant for a while upon other human beings. So he understands everything there, okay? We know that God, I guess you might say, broadened his experience. We know that God is omniscient, which means he knows everything there is to know. The Bible makes that clear in many places. We can understand that there in Hebrews chapter 4, there in verse 13. The Bible says, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So we know that he is omniscient. He knows everything. Proverbs chapter 15 and his omniscience tells us this in 15 in verse 3. It says there, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. So no matter where we go, we can't escape his presence. And of course, in Psalm 139, we read, well, we will read here in a minute. Psalm 139 says, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. Whither shall I go from thy spirit, or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me. Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. So you can see when you read this all the way through, that God knows every detail about our lives. He knows exactly how we feel. And of course, you know, there in John chapter 1 and verse 11, it said he came unto his own, and his own received him not. That was the Jewish people. But they received, in other words, he was rejected. He knows what it is to be rejected. We'll touch on that a little bit later. But anyway, the fact of the matter is, God knows everything. I don't know if you've ever thought much about that fact, that there were some things that God knew by observation only and not by experience. There are some things that God will never know by experience. For instance, he will never know what it is to tell a lie, because he doesn't lie. He'll never know what it is to bury his mother. He will never know what it is to let someone down. He knows these things by observation, but not by experience. When God became a man, he knows many things now that he only knew by observation before. Some of the things that he's observed are, and some of the things that he's experienced are negative in nature. While he was here, he knew, as we can see from Matthew chapter 4, and if you want to write the rest of these references down, you can. I'll just give you the reference on some of them. Matthew chapter 4 and verse 2, it said, "And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward and hungered." Well, I would think so. Amen. Okay. But he knows what hunger is. And you know what? He probably knows closer to what hunger really is than any of us in here. I don't know. Has anybody in here ever really, I mean, really been, I mean, to the point of starvation? Anybody ever fasted to that point? I haven't, okay. And I've read about some great men that used to carry on some long fasts and so forth like that. And I'm not one of them, okay. I like to break fast. That's what I like to do. All right. But anyway, he was really hungered, and that's something that I have not experienced. All right. And then talking about thirst, we look at John chapter 4, and of course we see that he's coming to the well there. And in verse 7 it said, "There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink." Why? Because he was thirsty. He was thirsty. He knows what it is. He knows we need that water. Look, if you will, at Luke, because this one might surprise you a little bit. We don't quite often think about it. But look at Luke chapter 22. Look at Luke chapter 22. And look at chapter 22. And look down here to verse 39. And it said, "And he came out and went as he was wont, to the Mount of Olives, and his disciples also followed him. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, Pray ye that ye enter not into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. There appeared an angel unto him from heaven and strengthening him." I think you can see here that Jesus knew what he was about to do as a human being. He knew what he was about to do, what was going to take place in his life, was something that's revolting to a human being. And I think that you might even say that he actually experienced possibly human fear at this time. And I'm sure that he did, because I believe that on the human side of Jesus Christ, he experienced all of the feelings and stuff that we have. That is what would make the temptation so real. Of course, we know that he was above being tempted, and it didn't yield to it. But that is amazing when you think about it, that he could have possibly experienced human fear. But I think he did. All right. Look at Mark chapter 4, if you will. How late am I getting? I guess I got better quit here. It's getting late, okay? Look at Mark chapter 4, verse 38, and we're going to close out with this. And it said, verse 37 said, that there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow, and they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Well, you see him asleep. What I'm trying to say is, as a human being, he grew weary at times. He grew tired. His body would get tired, just like yours and mine would. And so he'd have to go to sleep. Every bit is human, I guess you might say, as we are, except he was without sin.
Amen.
Now, that's our great high priest. We've got more to study on him next week, and we'll look at the rest of it next week. So we'll leave it there until then. And let's just close with a word of prayer, and we'll look to the next service. Father, thank you for the time we've had together. I pray, Lord God, that we would rejoice that we have such a great high priest. And Lord, we know that his work is not temporary. It's not something that just patches things up for a short while, but Lord, that it was permanent and that it lasts forever and that our salvation is always there. Lord, I pray that we would rest assured of what our Savior has done on our behalf and that he'll continue it on throughout all eternity. For we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay.